I've been riding on a daydream.
Thanks for checking out RV Daydream. It's a beautiful day outside.
It's going to be a little bit cloudier, and we got a little bit of rain in the forecast, but I got some stuff going on. What might that be? Well, we know what it is. I've got my rock shield on the truck. That means it's attached to the hitch. That means the hitch is attached there. And I'm draining out our fresh water because I don't need the fresh water. Why? Because we're gonna go camping and we're gonna have full hookups. The RV is jacked up a little bit. I'm just waiting for that stuff to drain out. And then I'm gonna back the truck up. I wanna show you a trick with an old Android phone, but let me give you some preface here.
I have a backup camera. I had one just kind of like it in the old F-150. Except it was a real small screen. Well, Heidi got me a bigger one, and I've had it for, like I mentioned before, I think about 5 months. I just haven't wired it in yet, and it's a big deal. It's just like everything else, I got stuff that I need to do. So I found this app for old Android devices. Now I have a couple of them. Okay, maybe not real quick. I shut off the truck and that stuff's still draining out there. So what it is an app called Alfred. And what you do is you put it on your device, your cell phone, which my phone is in the truck right now, in the cradle. And you take your old device, whatever that may be, like in my case, that old Moto X, and you make one a camera and you make one the display. So what happens is, like when we go away, we set up the Moto X, will be plugged into a cord, so it always got power. It stays on constantly, and I'll set it up in the house, and I can turn on motion detection, and it will monitor any kind of movement at all. And it picks up, I got it set pretty sensitive, so it picks up all kinds of movement. And then on my phone, I just leave the app running, and what happens is anytime there's any movement detected, I get a tone on my phone, just a little jingle. And it lets me see the short clip that it captured of the movement. Or I can hit watch live, and as soon as I hit it, it'll allow me to see what's going on. Not only that, but my son, like the other day, he was in the house wandering around, and it set off the motion detector a couple times, and he's normally asleep at that time. And it looked like he was looking for something. So on my phone, I just pushed the microphone button and it turns on the speaker on my phone at home. Now, you also get audio whenever you're looking at that live view. So anytime you get a live view shot, you just, or want to see what's happening at the house, you just click it and it opens it up and you can see and hear what's going on. So my son, when he was wandering around and he set off the alarm on the phone, I went ahead and I pushed the button and said, "Hey, what are you looking for, bud?" And then let off, and of course he just said, "Hey, I'm looking for the cold medicine." He says, "I can't sleep." He says, "My nose is really stuffy." It was just kind of neat that all that works. And the nice thing is there's not a connection constantly between the phone that's on your hip or in your pocket or your purse and the phone that's at home. The only time there's a connection is if you push a button and say you want it to connect, or if there's motion detected and it will ring you and send you a clip. That's the only thing. So you're not using up a ton of data. You just got the apps running. And of course, with the Wi-Fi in the house, the phone that's always viewing, it's not using any data either. Now, this app is free. Now, you've got ads that show up on it, and also the quality isn't HD quality. It's about 480 maybe. It's pretty low, I think. But it's not very much if you want to pay for the app, and I think it's like $3.99 a month, and you'll get HD quality and all kinds of other stuff that come with it. But for the time being, this thing works really nice, because when we're away from home, we'll leave it running and we know everything that's going on. It's just a nice feeling. Now, our kids will be here, Heidi will be here, she'll be in and out a couple of times, my daughter will be here with her boyfriend for a while. My son, of course, will be here, so it's not like the house is going to be empty. But still, I think that we'll set that up to where we're not invading on their privacy so they can have their own time in the house. But it will be set up to where it'll display any motion. it's kind of nice. If I want to know when UPS is delivering, or if I want to know if somebody's on our porch or anything like that, I can just set the phone up on the porch. Now, what's that got to do with RVing? Well, you can do this in your RV if you have constant Wi-Fi inside your RV, or you've got to have a setup for, your cellular data. You would have to turn cellular data on your phone. And again, it doesn't use cellular data all the time. It only uses it when you request to use it. So it'll just sit there and run and be looking for movement, looking for movement. And as soon as it sees movement, at that point, it will go into cellular data and it will send a signal out. It will connect with this phone. And then at that point, you can just watch the clip that it sent over, or you can push it and then connect it. And of course, both phones will be using cellular data at that point. Or if you're on Wi-Fi, you'll be using Wi-Fi. But either way, it's a really, really good little thing. Now, the nice thing about it is I have a real nice little Joby magnetic base that I can use for my phone. It's just a little magnetic base tripod. It's just a little short thing, not very big. And it's just for phone and lightweight cameras. And I'll show you what I'm doing with that right now.
Here I have it just stuck to the hitch of my truck, and it's, again, it's just magnetic that's holding it on there. Let me get a little closer for you. You can see, I'll put a link for this little tripod. It's kind of nice. It's a very strong magnet. So I talked about that before. And of course, the phone's pointed at the hitch. Now, the only thing is the display is backwards, which I'll show you that now. There is no mirror function for this because they figure you don't want to be seeing a mirror function. And that's the display. So again, it's not the best of quality, but you can see what's going on, and you can see that, you know, there's a hitch there and the ball, and all I want to do is just see distance. I just want to see when the RV casts the shadow over the ball. That makes it a little bit easier having something like this. And this will get me by for now. And again, the nice thing is we're going to be able to check out our house whenever we're gone on the road, or we can bring the phone with us and we can put it in our RV, and whenever we're away from the RV, it'll let us know if there's any motion around our RV. We could put it even outside the RV or in the window looking out. I mean, there's all kinds of things that can happen. So let's go ahead and move forward with this mess. Well, that took longer than I expected. Could you tell that I didn't know what the hell I wanted to do? Initially, I wanted to line it up alongside of the driveway, and then I thought, no, I'll just park it back on the patio, and then I realized that we need to bring stuff in and out of it. It's, the camper's not loaded, so it was too close to the garden, so I had to redo it again. What a joke.
I have to say that there is an advantage to having RVs that are taller, in the fact that whenever you need to level your camper, you have a lot less of a chance of needing to lower farther than it will go. Meaning, for example, if this slope was more steep than it currently is right here, I could only lower that tongue that far. That's all the farther I can lower it. So there's been times that we've gotten sites that have sloped down quite a bit, and we've had to raise the RV up on all the tires and wheels, you know, higher, so we could lower it more in the front to level it out.
Oh yeah, by the way, the last video that I was showing you guys that I mowed the lawn, that was on Wednesday. I had to mow it again today. It's just that time of year. I don't know if it's like that in the southern states where the sun is really hot and always coming down, but when you're this moist and this green in this area, you have a lot of growing happening as soon as the sun comes out, because there's plenty of water, there's plenty of moisture, so all it takes is sun. So whenever the sun's out, it starts growing, and it grows fast.
Alright, so we're almost ready to hook this thing up and drag it out of the yard and then load it up.
I wanted to get it out of the way and try to get the sun to dry out that area over there where the RV used to sit. I'm not going to leave till tomorrow, later in the day, probably around 3 o'clock, but it's got a lot of rain coming in. I wanted to try to dry this out more than it already is. Hopefully it will. So I went ahead and I charged my son's air conditioner in his van there, so the AC works in his van. I added a can of Freon to his car to make it a little bit colder than what it was. It was close, so I was kind of busy with that yesterday. I got really tired yesterday after I had mowed the lawn. I only had like 4.5 hours sleep the night before last. Last night I got about 6 hours sleep, so I feel pretty good today. But it's not something that'll allow me to stay alert and busy the whole day unless I get, you know, at least 7 hours sleep, maybe 7.5 hours sleep. So as far as loading up the truck, I was thinking about bringing the bikes, but we've got rain in the forecast, and if we want to do some exercise, we'll go ahead and just walk. All right, so I actually got something accomplished. We're hooked up, we're moved up. I cleaned up the RV a little bit, repainted some areas real quick, just touched up, rattle can. But I had a problem. If you guys that's been with me for a little while remember, whenever I was traveling to Tennessee, I had to pull over because I was getting an issue with this cord, the 7-way connector, being loosened up in the socket. And it used to be I had these flaps that I cut out, they were still there. I cut out both sides, and it made it a little easier for me to do this anti-rattle hitch thing that I've got rigged up here. You'll find that the more you guys watch me, the more you'll see me rig stuff up instead of possibly buying what I need. And this was just a leaf spring clamp replacement shackle, basically. So anyways, getting off topic here. The problem that I had was the cord was moving around inside here as we drove, and it would loosen up in the socket eventually that's back here, again, from this touching or just from vibrations. I had one of these pins, you know, just a regular hitch pin, that I don't use. I have a locking one, and I have extras. I probably have like 4 in the garage still. I even have 2 more locking ones, believe it or not. But what I did is I drilled it, and I just put a small indentation here. It's not drilled through all the way, but this side obviously is drilled through all the way, and I just put a bolt, a U-bolt with a couple springs that I had, and double nutted the end, and basically this becomes a captive device for that cord. So let me show you what I mean. I'll go ahead and hook it up here. We'll try it out. This is the first time actually that I hooked it up, so maybe I screwed up somehow. I can put the pin in to hold the hitch, so that don't come out. And now we'll go ahead and put this here. Well, let me get the cord up on the right side. There we go. And now the cord will actually just sneak in underneath there, and it's captive. This is going to keep it from being vibrated off just from slight movement. Other than this part here, which I could take away by putting a spring here, which I may do, to keep it up against. But yeah, this is what I came up with. So now I don't have to worry about the cord draping or being hit and making it to where it moves out of that plug. This will work for now. We'll see how this does on this short trip. Of course, whenever I'm done and I want to disconnect, it's nothing more than compressing the spring and twisting this out of the way, and now the cord's free and I can leave that in there. So again, we'll see how this works on this trip, and hopefully this will stay tight. There we go. Yeah, not bad. Let's see how that rig job works. I forgot to add that I also use this for the breakaway cable. I just slide it in and re-clip it. There, that way we're all hooked up and everything, I don't know, comes off relatively easy. Not bad. I've seen a lot worse, that's for sure. So now all I gotta do is put the display back on the camera so I can see what I'm filming. There we go. Now all I have to do is put the weight distribution bars on, and we're probably going to wait on that. I don't like leaving the tension bars full of tension. I can hook them up though. You know, I probably will do that. I'll probably at least connect them. And the reason that I'm doing all this
is simple. Look how cloudy it is behind me. Well, it's just going to get worse. Right now it's not so bad out. It's only going to be about a 20% chance to 40% chance of a spotty shower, but tomorrow's 80% chance of thunderstorms. So definitely not going to be the time for dorking around with weight distribution bars and hooking up and packing up all our stuff. So we're going to do everything we can tonight, so tomorrow I can just check out of here and take off and go whenever I want to leave. That's what we're going to do. Heidi had to bring her car home. She's got a bad tensioner on this thing. She was scared to death. She said, I think the crank is making some kind of noise. And she was kind of right. It was in that area, but it was just the tensioner shot on this. This thing has 200,000 miles, I think it is. So, you know, those things happen after a period of time. Heidi's the second owner. And the first owner was her sister-in-law. So it's kind of nice that we know all the history behind it. But that's it, guys. We'll pick this up whenever we're hopefully heading out.
Okay, one more tip. I forgot to tell you this, or I forgot to mention this in the past. If you guys are set up with a weight distributing hitch like this one, and you have the links, and everybody does the same thing, they know about how many links that they have, all that stuff. Well, I'm here to tell you that these bars will supply tension unequally to your RV unless everything is absolutely perfect. And I'm going to tell you right now, no RV is perfect. It's not perfect. It's close, but it's not exact. So this is what you need to do. You need to find out the exact same amount of tension for each bar, no matter how many links it is, so that it's equal. So let's say in my case, I need 8 links on this side, and on this side over here, I need 7 links. Well, I do two things to remind me of that. Well, first of all, the bars, since they're not equal, I make sure that I mark them. You can see I just have a paint marker, and I've marked D for driver's side, P for passenger side. So I know that this is the driver's side on this one right here. D there, and I put a D here. And right in a couple spots in case it starts to wear out. Not only do they do that on the bars, but the other thing that I do is I paint the link that's going to be used. So I'm not counting every time. It's just ridiculous that you gotta count links every single time. So both bars have a painted link on them. Although the paint is fading away on mine considerably, you can still see it. Now, above and beyond that, if the paint did wear off completely, I write down the number of links on the saddle. So I've got 8 over here, and I've got 7 over here. Again, the paint is horrible, and it's, you know, rubbing off and everything else, but you get the idea. I mean, it tells you how many links in case you don't see that one anymore, and you know what bar it is. Like I said, these things aren't equal. They're not the same. There's a difference. And I've gone through many bars and I bought them used just to get the tension that I think is just perfect for this RV and this truck combination. And of course, with our old truck too, we had the same weight distributing system. And it's just not, you know, it's not a thing that I want to continuously run unequal, because I'm counting links and I'm just matching what the other side does. So now I know what side goes where and how many links on each to have the same amount of tension, and it works really well. So now I'll let you guys go and we'll pick this up later.